In this episode, I have an interview with Chris Phelan. He is the research manager at USCIF. He's responsible for leading research, product output such as issue reports, blog posts, op-eds, supporting the production of the trends report, and thinking of new areas of research. This is All in One Financial. I'm Bill Holiday. We discuss financial planning issues, investing, taxes, estate planning, insurance, retirement planning, and right now we're focusing on sustainable, responsible impact investing. This is brought to you by AIO Financial, fee-only fiduciary financial planning firm working with clients all over the U.S., AIOfinancial.com. Thank you for joining me on this episode. Again, I have an interview with Chris Phelan with USCIF, which is a leading organization in shareholder engagement with sustainable, responsible impact investing. Let's go to the interview. Thank you, Chris, for joining me on this podcast.
No, thank you for having me.
I know you just came out with your trends report, but could you just give a little background on USCIF, what your goals are and what you do?
Yeah, so again, thanks for having me on here. We're really excited about the trends report. I think it shows a lot of really interesting data about the field, and happy to get into that more. But USCIF is the leading voice advancing sustainable investing across all asset classes and types of firms and funds in the U.S. We are focused on rapidly shifting investment practices towards sustainability across the U.S. And so we have three main areas of focus, which is policy. So working with Congress, the executive agencies at the federal level in particular, that would be the Securities Exchange Commission, the Department of Labor, education. We put out a number of resources for financial advisors, money managers, retail investors. Actually, we have something new out for retail investors, a short intro course. And then research, which is my area, which the trends report is our main output every 2 years, which is basically the definitive snapshot of the industry. And, you know, we've seen some big growth. So excited to share that.
Okay, great. Well, why don't we just dive into the trends report? What are your big takeaways? I know the big number that it's just grown a lot, even over the last 2 years to in $3.
$1 in $3. Yeah, that is what we have found. And that, you know, that is a very exciting number. I think the big takeaways, I think, are the importance of climate change and some other environmental ESG criteria, particularly it feels a bit to me, and this is my kind of personal opinion that I am still working out, that a lot of investment in climate change or decarbonization is getting a bit saturated. And so people and money managers and, you know, asset owners, retail investors are looking for what's the next step we can take towards our climate or environmental goals. And we saw a huge jump in a focus on sustainable natural resources and agriculture, like came totally out of nowhere. So that was a really important trend that we saw. Another big takeaway
could you break that down just a little? So we're saying the bottom line, there's like one in three investment dollars in the US, $17 trillion are, and they're saying assets under management using sustainable investing strategies. You're saying climate change and agriculture and those issues, but are those shareholder advocacy pieces or are those part of this? I mean, what part of the one third of all dollars is really trying to make a difference, or what part is just they're seeing trends and they're trying to make money or they're trying to avoid certain things? I'm not sure if you can break that down.
Yeah, that's a good question. And I'll try to, it's a little bit complicated. And I know some people have a lot of questions about some of the complexities in the report. But basically, when we say strategies, we mean ESG incorporation, which has other sub things under it, or shareholder engagement. So it could be across either one of those. And we do remove double counting for the purposes of institutional investors and money managers. Let's say for sustainable natural resource and agriculture, maybe a money manager has gone to a large corporate agriculture company and has put forward a resolution on GMOs or something, or a money management firm or portfolio manager provider has as part of their ESG integration analytical framework where they want to see a company tell what their soil regeneration processes or what those metrics are, or how much food is produced sustainably or that is certified. So there's different ways that people can break it down, but sustainable natural resources would be a criteria that would then be applied under ESG incorporation or shareholder engagement.
So you've just seen a lot more people, one, a lot more people using these, using sustainable strategies, but within that, you've seen a lot more people moving towards the sustainable climate change type issue.
Yeah. I think sustainable natural resources for money managers, at least, was not even in the top 10 criteria in 2018. So it's grown by like 90%+ in 2 years. It's really quite impressive.
Oh, yeah, that's interesting, because 2 years ago, not that long ago.
No, not at all.
A longer period of time. Yeah, climate change has become a bigger issue. Yeah, that's a pretty short period of time.
For money managers, they say that they have $2.4 trillion that they consider using this, that they manage using this criteria, and $4.2 trillion that they manage with an eye towards traditional climate change and carbon investments, carbon reduction investments, I should say.
Yeah, that's significant.
Mm-hmm. No, absolutely. It's very interesting. I don't know if you have any other questions on that. I have a few other things I could go into that we could dive into. But
of course, can I just break this out real quickly? So of the $17 trillion using these strategies, about $12 trillion is institutional investors and about $5 trillion is retail. Mm-hmm. Retail is the common people. I mean, just most of us. What would be examples of institutional? Because that is considerably more.
Yeah, so institutional asset owners, the largest chunk of those are what we call public funds. So basically state pension funds, that's really the biggest one. You think of CalSTRS, CalPERS, the New York Comptroller, the New York State Retirement Fund. So that makes up a huge chunk of the institutional asset owners. And then the second biggest chunk is insurance companies. Oh, it's about $2.2 trillion, but it only, in our report, is 17 companies, but they have a lot of money. And yeah, I think people have, well, at least I have seen a lot of recent media and financial analysis about like the very immediate risks posed by, in particular, climate change to the insurance industry that I think they're trying to mitigate against, particularly those who have sold policies in coastal areas or in the desert where we are. So, you know, quite interesting. Those are the two biggest by far chunks. Then other ones are educational institutions, so university endowments, foundations, family offices, faith-based other organizations, or like groups of churches or nuns themselves. So that is what the institutional asset owner.
Okay, but public is a big one. And you're seeing public funds, a lot of them using these sustainable strategies. Insurance companies, it's kind of funny because they sort of have an inside track on the impacts of climate change as they're calculating insurance numbers.
Yeah. So for public funds, what's really important to them, and this is the top criteria for public funds, is what we call conflict risk. So doing business or having investments in repressive or designated terrorist regimes, particularly Sudan and Iran, those are normally statutorily required by either the state or the federal government, or they just follow what the State Department says. So, you know, if we're being honest, some people I've heard question if that is sustainable investment. It is doing something good by not funding these places, but after that, they care about labor rights, board issues, divesting from tobacco, and climate change and carbon. So you can see how labor rights and board issues would be really important to the people who are putting their money into a state employee's pension fund.
Yes, I that makes sense that they'd have some different screens from maybe retail investors, but definitely there's some issues they'd want to screen for.
Yeah. And regarding institutional investors, we of that $12 trillion that money managers said that they manage on behalf of institutional asset owners, our survey and research only captured about $6 trillion of that. So, you know, I'm sure I'll touch upon this again as we talk, but we would love to see more disclosure and more answers to our survey. think the more information, the better.
Get you, but you know there's 12 trillion out there that are using these criteria, but you've only gotten feedback from half of them about what specifically they're engaging about or what their issues are?
Yeah, because I think money managers are not required to say anything about their institutional clients outside of the fact that they exist. So, you know, some do, some don't. And so a lot of the information that we get for the institutional asset owner chapter or institutional investor chapter comes directly from either their responses or what we can glean from the information that they've put out publicly, either filings or just marketing materials, not the right word, but things highlighting what they do.
So dollar amount, we've got these public funds, insurance, and then some retail investors. What about who's the most active of those? Are public funds very active, or who would top the list of active?
In terms of like filing shareholder proposals?
Engaging with companies, yeah.
Yeah, so that's a really good question. Public funds in asset-weighted terms are the most active. They have the most money that goes towards filing shareholder resolutions. Faith-based institutions have filed the most resolutions. So faith-based institutions are the most active, but they don't have a lot of money. Public funds have the most money and are the fourth most active. So
Who rounds out the top, that top five group? So you have public funds,
money managers, labor funds, faith-based funds, and family offices. The top three, public funds, money managers, and labor, are the vast majority of money that is being utilized for shareholder resolutions. And the number that are filed is a bit more even. So faith-based, then money managers, there's about 1 percentage point difference there, then foundations and public funds and labor unions. So a lot of our members, the money managers, are filing these shareholder resolutions.
Gotcha.
So it's a little bit of a, you know, kind of tricky to think about with me just saying it. But luckily, we have a nice graphic in our materials that hopefully your listeners can go check out.
Money managers, could you break that down? I mean, is that going to be your mutual fund companies or?
Under money managers, yeah, we include like registered investment companies, which are mutual funds, variable annuities, ETFs, closed-end funds. And then we also have alternatives, so like private equity or hedge funds, other commingled funds. One that's really important and has been growing this year in particular, but is still kind of a small asset amount, it's community investment institutions. I personally suspect that there's been a lot of growth in the period since we closed our research and now, especially in the community investing institutions. And then the infamous undisclosed investment vehicles. That is a huge chunk. Essentially, that means that when someone was going to fill out the survey or in their public filings with the SEC, that they didn't tell us or we couldn't determine what the actual investment vehicle utilized for their money was. So they didn't tell us if it was in a mutual fund or in a separate account or in an ETF or something. So to come back to the point I made earlier, it would really behoove everyone in the industry if we were able to kind of press ourselves to provide more and better information that, you know, that can really build out this report and everything that we're trying to do.
I agree. I mean, it seems like people in this community, it would be better for everyone to have more information to see how things are moving.
Yeah, yeah. And I think it's a bit of a first mover kind of thing. A lot of people, a lot of managers have large mandates from, let's say, public pension funds around the world that they just aren't really that comfortable disclosing right now, similar to the fact like the institutional asset owner, institutional investor piece that we talked about just a minute ago, that they just don't have to disclose it and they don't want to be the one who kind of breaks the code of silence of the industry and has something go wrong because of it. I think we would dispute that premise, and that having that information for this report is totally anonymized. I think that people should really start within the industry just pressing ourselves for more information.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. Could you break down community investing a little?
Yes, that's a really good question. So community investing, we lump it into four different kind of institutions. First of all, community investment assets doubled between 2014 and 2016. They doubled again between 2016 and 2018. And
Wow.
between 2018 and 2020, they grew by 44%, up to $266 billion. And there are 1,200 community investing institutions in the United States, which is also up. So the largest in asset-weighted terms type of institution is community development credit unions. And then we also have community development banks, community development loan funds, and then community development venture capital funds, which are quite small. But that's how we break down those the community investing types.
In community development credit union, as opposed to just a local credit union, the difference is they went out and sought a designation or certification.
I believe so.
What else could you point out in the report that you've seen in the new
I
one?
think shareholder resolutions are quite interesting. The corporate political activity, so lobbying and corporate, the use of corporate money is really germane to the current times. You know, the Business Roundtable earlier this year was talking about the new form of stakeholder capitalism, where you consider all of your stakeholders, not just shareholders, and putting that into practice. And I think a lot of people are trust but verify is how people are thinking about it. And you see that from 2018 to 2020, investors want to make sure that companies aren't giving money to organizations that are going against their public statements. I think that's something that's really important because, you know, the board can have a lot of great rules and regulations and disclosures for the company. But if they're funding some outside groups that are extremely powerful and undermining everything on their behalf, it kind of defeats the purpose. So people are really worried about that. And you definitely see that it is by far the most shareholder proposals were filed between 2018 and 2020 on that.
Well, the most popular you just said were corporate political activity was shareholder resolutions being proposed to disclose what they're doing or to control what they're doing, or like what's an example of a corporate political resolution?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I think it's both. One, to disclose, and two, to stop doing it. I
Okay.
think people it's kind of a choose your strategy. What do you think is going to get the most the most traction immediately, either just to disclose it. And in theory, you know, disclosing kind of would force people to not do it anymore. If their shareholders start to see what they're doing, it's like, well, stop.
No, because you're going to turn away half the population, whichever way
Exactly.
you're pushing the money. So if being partisan might not be the smartest idea for a public company.
Yeah, exactly. So those are two types. I think this is not my opinion, but people like to see, you know, what companies are doing, like with the Chamber of Commerce, for example, disclosing that's the information that they're trying to get to. I don't think a resolution would say disclose you're giving to the Chamber of Commerce exactly, but that's the point that they're trying to reach. Yeah, we didn't include any specific examples that I can link to right now of a resolution like that, but it is the most frequently proposed. And you know, if any of you or your listeners are interested, I can definitely find specific examples of that if anyone's looking to get involved on that front.
What in is that up because of an election year? Like, did you see a tick up in 2016, or is it's just up
It's
regardless of
just
the
up.
year?
So it's in 2018, it was the most. In 2019, it was the most. And in 2020, it looks like either the most or the second most. So labor and equal opportunity and employment was also very big in 2020. But you stack those on each other, it's the longest, yeah. And I suspect you're going to see going into the 2021 and 2022 proxy seasons, a lot more focus on labor rights, human rights, health and wellness, and racial justice. I think that'll also manifest itself in diversity pushes. Not just at the board level anymore. I think people are going to want to see it more so throughout company talent pipelines. Again, my opinion.
So making a shareholder resolution, board of directors makes sense because those are going to be resolutions on who gets on the board, but also on your executive staff.
Yeah, I think.
Criteria or making sure there's diverse representation.
Yeah, I think that it's much more difficult probably legally to do what investors have done with the board, where you ask for a mandate of, you know, X number of people or X percent be women or minorities. In the rest of the company, I think an investor would be interested in seeing like a diversity hiring policy and then making sure that there's disclosure of the data to make sure that the company is backing up what it says throughout the company. Labor practices would be, I think, retention, average pay, what are the benefits being offered? So just getting a lot of this information that we don't know out into the open, because if you're looking for a sustainable economy and people to be safe in crises and allow, not to be too cynical about it, but to allow the economy to grow in times like this, you need people to be taken care of. And, you know, we see from all the economic turmoil right now that that's been tough.
Yeah, well, and labor practices too. I was just thinking, yeah, it would be good to have diverse criteria, but it's also just make it equal too. Just don't
right.
discriminate would be a probably a positive step with a lot of companies.
It's a good starting point. Yeah, absolutely.
What, as far as shareholder resolution, so corporate political activity, the labor and equal employment opportunity. What other big ones have you seen?
Climate change is still huge. People want greenhouse gas reduction targets. They want plans. Those are that's really the crux of the climate change. And we actually do have a number of examples that we list out in the report. So at Anadarko Petroleum in 2018, there was a shareholder resolution passed requiring a report on 2-degree analysis and strategy that would be their strategy to keep the climate below from rising more than 2 degrees Celsius. That passed with 53%. Phillips 66, report on climate-related extreme weather impacts, that passed. There was one at Exxon, I think, before this. It was in 2016 or 2017 that required them to put out a greenhouse gas emissions reduction target and plan. So you see a lot passing on climate change. I say they have a pretty good pass rate. Then there's executive pay is the fourth most common type of resolution, and independent board chair is the fifth. So those kind of go together. An example of independent board chair would be separating Mark Zuckerberg from being the CEO and the board chair, and also making sure that the chairman of the board is not a part of the company. You know, it's an independent person who is only tied to the fiduciary interest of the shareholders and the stakeholders in the company, rather than having themselves fully tied in as well.
That makes sense. Yeah, I could see that. The climate change one, I was just thinking, if there was more pressure because of the administration, and would that change? But I also think there's just a lot of awareness and movement towards climate change. So it probably won't slow down, I'd imagine.
No, I don't think it will slow down, especially in the absence of federally mandated disclosure regulations or, you know, rules about this, which we can all be hopeful, but that's very difficult. I think there will probably be some people working towards more climate disclosure legislation, so greenhouse gas disclosure, methane disclosures, things like that. We'll see if those can get passed through Congress. So I think in the meantime, people are still really quite focused on using their voices in companies to further this kind of work.
Yeah, I agree. You can't let up, even if the administration moves in a positive direction. Corporations have so much power that it's good to be pushing them in a good direction.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And to answer your other question that led to this discussion, what else in the report? I think it's just becoming really clear how interrelated all of these are. You know, so the E gets a ton of exposure and focus because it's so immediate. Climate change is coming down, but you can't have changes to companies if you don't have good governance. The environmental catastrophes are going to impact the most vulnerable people first, the poor, communities of color, you know, Native American tribes. So I think as companies and investors start to view it holistically like that, I think we'll see hopefully more collaboration and more effective collaboration and community between the securities issuers and the managers and financial advisors who are trying to move forward their clients' goals. I think people are starting to realize this, and I hope that comes across through the report that it all matters and it all touches itself in different ways.
Yeah, I like that. I do think of the environmental being really important, and then social definitely, but governance is like my least, don't think about it that much, but you're right, it ties into everything else. It kind of
controls exactly.
The rest of how the company's moving.
Yeah, governance is definitely the least sexy, I think, but you have a good... If you have a board chair that's willing to disclose corporate political activity or to, stop it from happening, that can have a huge impact down the line on those issues that people care about. Minimum wage, greenhouse gas, you could keep going and going.
Yeah, no, I agree. Anything else you wanted to add? Otherwise, I wanted to tell people where they can find out about this and get in touch with you.
Nothing else to add right now. I think, I hope people were able to take away just how important this is to a growing portion of the U.S. population and how it's really being put into practice with huge amounts of money and is proving itself both impactful and not a money-losing venture, in fact, often a money-gaining venture, and despite what you might see in some of the press. I welcome any questions, any outreach from any of your listeners, and you can find the report and various one-pagers in the executive summary at USSIF, that's USSIF, .org. Yeah, so thank you so much. This was really great. I hope you enjoyed it and everyone else did too.
No, thank you, Chris, for your time. That's really helpful breaking some of this down. Can I include a contact information for you? What's the best? Where can people find you? Either is there social media or email or?
Yeah, email's fine. I like getting emails. I know I'm weird. It's CPHALEN as in Nancy at USSIF. .org.
Okay. I'll put a link in the blog post.
That's great.
That's linked to this.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Okay, super. Well, thank you very much, Chris, for your time.
Thank you. Have a great one. Thank you.
All right. Thank you for listening to AIO Financial. This has been brought to you by AIO Financial. If you need help with any part of your finances, please contact AIO Financial at aiofinancial.com. We do have a free Sustainable Responsible Impact Investing ebook at impactfinancialplanners.com/SRI ebook. We are also starting to offer some consulting services, SRI consulting services to financial advisors. We have a buy list of the funds that we use for different asset classes that gets updated every 6 months. We're also offering a consultation with your firm, access to the buy list, and you'll be posted or listed in our SRI directory, impactinvestingfirms.com. You'll also get a newsletter and be in our private LinkedIn group. And you can find out more about that at aiofinancial.com/SRI-advisor-consultant. I don't know. Hopefully it'll be somewhere on this page. That's hard to remember. I appreciate any of your comments, any feedback. Please let me know what you think, any ideas you have. I'd like to continue doing this. I'd like to meet an audience's needs. So if you do have any ideas or interest targets, let me know. If you do like these videos or podcasts, please leave a rating, subscribe so other people can find this. And you can leave comments. I will respond in person if I see comments, or email or contact me in other ways. You can find out a variety of ways to get in touch with me at aiofinancial.com. All right. Thank you very much. Take care. Stay well.